today. I'm thrilled to have Bruce and Josh Hudson here with me from Kent in Washington State. Bruce Hudson and his late wife Sue started Hudson's Photography in the Seattle area in 1982 when they took their wonderful hobby of photography and turned it into a full-time profession. However, they didn't want to just another same-as-everyone-else portrait studio, so Bruce and Sue's main focus was to build a business on the strong foundation of superior customer service and innovative photography. Bruce has won numerous local, national, and international accolades, and thousands of photographers have personally studied with him over the years. Today, Hudson's Portrait Design is considered one of the top family portrait and wedding photography studios in the country. 29 years later, the focus is still centered solely on the photographic needs of their clients. In fact, many of their early high school senior clients from the 1980s returned later as brides and grooms. They then came back again as parents of newborn children, as family portrait clients, and even parents of high school senior clients. Today, Bruce is joined by his son Josh in the business, and they work also together to help other photographers succeed through their mentorship program. So, hi guys, it's really great to have you both here with us today.
Hey, happy to be here. Thanks for having us, Nigel.
Yeah, thanks.
So today's topic is all about the business of family portrait photography and how to succeed with premium wall portraits. So to get started, what was that first spark of inspiration that got you both interested in becoming professional photographers?
Well, my first spark, this is Bruce, and we sound a lot alike, so we'll probably let you know who's talking, but probably my first real spark came from three different people. When it comes to family wall decor, one was Ken Whitmire, who is in Yakima, Washington, a small little town in the middle of the state. Studied with him about 30 years ago. Also studied with Chuck Lewis and Lisa Evans from the San Francisco area. So those three people I studied with all within 6 months, and all their focus was on selling large wall portraiture. So it was marketing, being able to learn how to take, you know, shots that were tailored for large portraits, and then how to sell. So I was kind of indoctrinated, you know, fairly early in the business.
What about you, Josh? How did you get into this business?
Oh, how did I get sucked in? Yeah, I grew up, I mean, literally in the business. In 1982, in August, is when my parents left their full-time jobs. My dad was a high school band director and had been doing that for about 4 years. And my mom worked for the city of Renton, which is where both my father and I live, within the city limits of Renton here, just south of Seattle. If you know Boeing, that's where the 737 aircraft is made, and PACCAR, and a lot of tech startups down here. Basically, I was born in November of 82, so my parents really had to learn how to generate some serious cash flow early on in the business after you know, leaving their cush government jobs and going out as entrepreneurs. So yeah, I mean, pretty much my Saturdays were filled with holding reflectors and carrying equipment at weddings where all my friends were off having fun. And my evenings were putting stamps on newsletters and marketing postcards going out to clients. So I mean, from the very beginning, I was a photographer's kid, and you know, never really wanted anything to do with the business until I went away to college and got my degree in political science, and was actually applying to various law schools, and had about a year or so between when I was going to start law school. So I kind of came back, and my dad said, "Hey, why don't you come to the studio? I got some projects I can put you on while you're waiting to hear back and your next step." And I kind of fell in love with the business because it was the first time in my life where I didn't really have to work the business. So that's kind of how I got sucked in. I, believe it or not, turned down going to law school to work with my dad and continue to help him at the studio and a lot of our educational and teaching things that we do.
So right from the very beginning, back in 1982, you took an approach that focused on providing premium customer service. Was that a conscious choice at the time? I know you mentioned that you had studied under people like Chuck Lewis, who, you know, obviously advocate that kind of model. But, you know, how did it affect the way that you did business right back then in the beginning?
Well, we have a company here in the Seattle area that is now, you know, nationwide, and it's called Nordstrom's. Nordstrom's has an incredible customer service and return policy and all that. And quite frankly, if you don't abide by that type of business model in any kind of business here in the Seattle area, you're probably not going to succeed. So we didn't have a choice, but it's also, you know, it's the best business model you can have. I just got off the phone coming back from a client here just a few minutes ago, and it was a client that we've been working with for 30 plus years. And if you look in their home, they have numerous 50, 60, and 40-inch prints in their home. And it's a pretty modest home, but we just finished doing their sixth portrait in 30 years, all family. And you can imagine each portrait we do, the family gets bigger and bigger and bigger. I went and delivered some last-minute images to her earlier this week and had the florist, a local florist, sent her a big bouquet of flowers. And so she got that today. So she called me to thank so much, not just for the flowers, but for everything we've done the past 30 years. So it takes a little bit more time and effort and money to cater to these kind of clients, but it comes back tenfold. It really does.
You mentioned that because of the prevalence of Nordstrom's in that area and that type of premium quality business, that the people around there seem to expect a higher level of quality of service and that kind of thing. So maybe, you know, photographers listening to this might think, oh, well, we don't have anything like that where I live. You know, the people here couldn't care less, you know. Is the type of business model that you have, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in just a second, but is that something that can work in a lot of places, or does it really heavily depend on the location where you're at?
And we get that a lot. Is, you know, people go, you know, does all this, you know, buying flowers for your clients and showing up with a nice bottle of wine when you deliver the portraits and calling if you're going to run 5 minutes late, you know, does all that really have an effect on your business and your bottom line? And I'd say absolutely. I think the myth that a lot of photographers think is they think in order to be successful in this business, you have to be a world-class artist. And it really isn't the case. I mean, there's photographers out there that could literally shoot circles around my dad. And this is from his own words. He says this when we're speaking, but it's the fact that our clients love us. We've created a culture and we really go out of our way to make sure that they're happy. And I think that a lot of photographers out there listening probably think, well, people are going to gravitate towards me because of my artistry. That's only about 10% of the business. 90% of it is client workflow. It's marketing, it's building a brand, and it's genuinely wanting to take care of your clients. So I think from the beginning, and even my dad will say this, that he wasn't the best photographer when he started out. You know, his talent and his growth as an artist, you know, came later. But in the beginning, it was people came to Hudson's because they liked my mom and dad, and they liked working with them. It wasn't necessarily because he was an award-winning master photographer like he is today. It's because people really enjoyed working with them. So I think for everyone out there that's listening that maybe doesn't have a Nordstrom-type culture in your city or your town, anything you can do to stand out from your competition, and it's not always photographically. I mean, one quick example here, and then we'll move on, is this weekend we have our annual Portraits in the Leaves event out at this park here just south of Seattle. Every year we schedule 6, 7, or 8 sessions on a Saturday, 6, 7, 8 sessions on a Sunday. And we basically take over this park and we take over a picnic area. And I bring big Hudson's banners and my dad makes his homemade chili and my wife makes pumpkin spice cookies and we have cider for the kids. And we're even going to have the Seattle Seahawks game streaming on a laptop on Sunday so all the dads don't miss out. But I mean, you know, flowers and candles and tablecloths. And that's the type of experience that we try to create for our clients. So whether you want to call it customer service or creating experience, I mean, that's what we do to help ourselves stand out. Because now there's about a dozen other photographers out there running around all day, you know, and it's the fact that we take the time to really make it a first-class experience for our clients is one reason why they stay with us for 30 years and keep coming back. So I would use that just as one example, and it's something that you could do in any town, any city, anywhere in the country.
I suppose also that by giving that level of service, it helps to maintain the high price levels that you need to charge, obviously, for the type of work that you do. If you treated your customers just like normal, like everybody else, you know, and didn't do all that stuff and then said, well, hey, it's several thousand dollars for a portrait or whatever, then you might have a bit of a harder time, right?
Exactly. You know, the credibility side is huge. But like Josh said, you know, the experience side is what people remember. It's what kids remember growing up. And, you know, we are working on second generation high school seniors, second generation wedding clients now. It's pretty amazing for these families to, you know, the kids to remember these kind of things and then come back 20 years later and say, you know, I remember when you guys used to do this and this and this. And, you know, I would never go anywhere else but Hudson's because of that.
That's a real testament, isn't it?
Yeah. And Josh was... You should talk about the Facebook war.
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, we're promoting our Portraits and Leaves. I think we have one session time open on Sunday and two on Saturday, which they'll be filled up this week. But I did kind of a promoted Facebook post just to our followers, our clients. And somebody who's not a client had gotten it in their feed and had commented, so, you know, how much does it cost? And, you know, session fee's $200 and let's get you in for a consultation and we'll go over the rest and, you know, excited to meet you. And she's like, $200 just for the session? That doesn't include a CD? And, like, you know, and then I don't have to say anything. You know, all of our clients that had commented on that about what is such a fun event, they start beating up on her. They're like, you can't beat Hudson's quality. You know, it's an investment. He's not like any other. I mean, it's like, and I'm watching our clients defend us, you know, and it's like, and it is, it's a testament. I mean, when you have an educated client that understands the process, which we'll hopefully talk about here today, our kind of wall portrait process, they become true believers. You know, I mean, it's, forget who wrote the book, Creating a Cult Brand, but, you know, Apple has it and Harley Davidson has it. And we here at Hudson's have done our job over the years to create that cult following of people that would never go anywhere else.
That is incredible. Having your clients beating up on people who dare to say something negative about you, I think that's fantastic.
Gotta love social media.
Absolutely. So you focus on portraiture and weddings too, of course. But do you feel it's important for photographers today to try and identify and focus primarily on one specific niche as a main thing? I mean, it's okay to have other things perhaps, but how important is it to have a specific niche to focus on?
Well, we have a lot of different niches, okay? And so if, you know, somebody calls and say, do you do senior portraits? Oh yeah, we specialize in senior portraits. Or if somebody calls and says, do you do commercial work, corporate work? Yes, we really concentrate, and that's one of our niches. So we try to have a kind of a separate brand for each type of product that we're selling. And this is something that when 2008 hit, we kind of learned the hard way, because we had gotten complacent, especially on our website. And we had one website that had kind of everything on there, and it didn't show really what we could do in each area, in each arena. So the first one that we kind of branded separately was our high school senior brand. After we started a whole new website and really focused on putting our best foot forward and best images and really concentrating on seniors in that website, our sessions went up 150% that next year. You know, it'd be nice if, you know, all you could do was gourmet family portraits or boudoir or seniors. But in this day and age, I think you have to really diversify. And that's one thing that we've done. But within that diversification, we also let our clients know, or prospective clients know, that we specialize in that particular niche.
Right. And that's a very significant difference, I think, you know, compared to, let's say, a new photographer jumping into the business and thinking to themselves, well, I'm new, I don't really know what I'm doing yet, I might specialize in portraits, I might do weddings, I feel like I have to do everything because I need to get the money in. So I'll just say I do everything on my one website and not really focus on branding each of those areas separately, but also with consideration to the overarching brand of the whole business. And I think that's the distinction that you were making there, right?
Yeah, absolutely. When 2008 hit, I mean, it was, you know, a big wake-up call for not just photographers, but just business in general. And it's one reason why our commercial photography side of the business has actually boomed since then, because most businesses, doctors, dentists, lawyers, chiropractors, you name it, who have never really had to market, now all of a sudden we're seeing their referrals drop by 30%, and they're going, oh, I guess we should finish that website that we bought 2 years ago, and I guess we should start doing new brochures. And so our business actually in the commercial side of it actually grew during that time, which was nice, because as you know, the wedding industry has changed so much. We're just not doing as many weddings, nor do we want to do weddings for $500 and a disc like a lot of people are doing. So we've decided to kind of diversify into different spaces, but it's kind of maintaining a separate brand for each. So if you go to HudsonPortraits.com, it's all about family, weddings, and high and children, but the emphasis is really on family. I mean, that's really what we're known for, and that's about 40-45% of our revenue every year is the large family wall decor. And then you go to our niche high school senior website, it's all about seniors. And funny enough, the reason, or one of the reasons why we came up with that separate niche for seniors, was we did a focus group with a group of high school kids at a local high school, and we had them analyze our brand, and we said, just lay it on us. What do you think? They said, it looks old. You have a stupid page on your stupid old website that's got stupid dated pictures on it. How is that supposed to get me excited about having my senior pictures done with you when my friend is doing some cool stuff on their iPhone? So that hit us between the eyes, and it really forced us to, you know what, we got to work 10 times as hard as we used to. You know, even being in business at that point for 25 years and my dad and his reputation, it forced us to up our game, and we did that on every aspect of our business. It didn't happen overnight, but now we're back to actually pre-recession levels of revenue here at the studio. Which is nice. But putting that emphasis, you know, niching wall decor for families, niching commercial and niching high school seniors, all kind of separate, but at the same time equal.
Something else that happened as a result of 2008 too, and is still going on today really, is that because so many people lost their jobs back then, a lot of them looked around their house, saw a nice little camera sitting around on a table and thought, well, I haven't got a job, I guess I could probably go out and try and make a living as a photographer. And so they woke up the next day, called themselves pros and jumped into the market. And many of the photographers that I talk to every week, you know, they complain to me about, oh, well, there's so much competition, there's photographers popping up left and right, and all they're trying to do is undercut everybody, and they keep calling me up and asking me what I'm charging, and so that they can charge less, and all this kind of thing. What advice might you guys have to help them compete more effectively, or just forget about it kind of thing?
To me, I think it's easier these days when you take a look at it. Back 20 years ago, you had people that were not charging that much for photography and they were giving the negatives away. Then you had kind of the middle market, which that's where most people resided. And then you had the upper, the boutique, they call them boutique studios now, or carriage trade kind of thing. I believe that that middle market has gone away, and it's now the people that are just starting and that are giving the CDs away, and then the upper end. And so for us, like Josh used the term, hit them right between the eyes. When people come in for a consultation and we go through the whole process, kind of the education, and get them excited about what we do, you know, do people still ask for the CD or images, electronic images? Sure they do. But we also, you know, let them know that's not our point. We're not here to sell you things on a CD. We're doing large wall decor, more pieces of artwork. And hopefully when they're sitting in the consultation room or in our studio and they're looking around these beautiful large wall decor prints, they see this is what we do. We don't sell the CD. And for the people that don't get that, typically are not our clients, and that's okay. Chuck Lewis said it so well many, many years ago that not everybody is going to be your client. And I think for the newer photographers, they can do what they want to do. I'm not worried about that. I just want to be able to attract the type of client that will appreciate what I do, has the resources to pay what we want to charge, that type of thing. So to me, it's a little bit easier now making that separation. We were in Ohio a couple weeks ago doing an all-day program and just talking with these studios, and most of them were established studios, and they were just like, you know, what do we do? How do we compete against all these other, you know, people starting out, giving everything on a CD? And our answer was, you don't compete with them. You're at a different level. You just need to educate your prospective clients that you are at a different level.
And I'll jump in here, Nigel, because I'm glad my dad brought this up, because for us, we're not competing with the photographer down the street. We're competing with the Disneyland vacation, or we're competing with the vacation to Maui, or we're competing with deciding to buy a second home and having a second mortgage payment, or we're competing with buying the new sports car. I mean, it's not that our photography, you know, I mean, some people do spend that much money, but I mean, it's not that we're, you know, way, way up there, but it's people's priorities are going to be people's priorities. And when people call or they come in for a consultation and, you know, well, I just want a bunch of digital images. I said, well, if you're more concerned about your Facebook wall than you are in the walls in your home, we're probably not the right studio for you. here in our studio, I mean, we literally turn lifestyles into works of art that you're going to be able to enjoy for generations to come. And, you know, this is what we do, and we present it in such a way that, I mean, we book a lot of sessions from people that come in, and I think a lot of it comes down to perception. And most photographers don't do a good job of defining themselves. And I have a saying that I've been using: if you don't define yourself, the consumer will. So if a photographer is having a hard time and is losing sessions to all these newbies out there that are, you know, just getting started and they don't know any better. They're selling the CD because that's what everybody on Smug Mug is doing. You know, I tell them, I said, you know, you have to define yourself differently. And if you don't, the consumer will rope you in with everybody else. And that starts with your website, the brand that you build, the customer service. Are you doing consultations? Do you have a physical studio? All that kind of stuff plays into it.
That's incredible. That's the first time I think that I've heard somebody say you're competing with the other things that the prospects or clients would otherwise spend their money on, instead of saying, well, you're competing with another photographer. That's an interesting point. I hadn't really ever looked at it like that before, but it makes perfect sense.
It's revelations of living through this down and stagnant economy. And I don't want to get into politics here, but I have a pretty strong stance on a lot of this stuff. But it's, you know, it's analyzing, and we're real big on numbers here at the studio. We have our perfect client profile. We know who our client is. I mean, we track everything. And, you know, just talking with people and just saying, you know, especially clients that have used us for years who we maybe haven't seen in a while, what made you decide to come back now? And it's, well, you know, we lost half our portfolio and it's taken us 4 years to get it back. And, you know, I love you, Bruce, but I'm not going to sacrifice, you know, the mortgage payment on our cabin in the mountains to get a new family portrait. That's when it hits you and you go, okay, it's not that they don't like us, that they don't want to come back. The desire for what we're doing just wasn't up there with other priorities in their life. So what can we do to create more desire and create more opportunities for these people to come back? And that's really been kind of the what we've been doing the last few years.
Let's talk about the actual business model that you have in place for family portraits. Can you give us a quick rundown of how that works?
Sure. We put ourselves out there and our marketing out there to attract, like Josh said, the perfect client. We have that pretty well established in our culture, the studio culture, who that is. And so we do the type of marketing that's going to attract those kind of people. Once they contact us, we schedule a consultation. They come in to the studio here. We play a slideshow to kind of show them the process of what we do. A lot of people have no clue what a professional photographer can really do. So we show them a lot of examples of a lot of on-location kind of things with a lot of lifestyle elements in there. After we show them all the possibilities and we kind of go through a process of questions, finding out, you know, why they're coming in to have their portrait taken, we kind of find out what they like to do as a family. So a lot of these questions, we're building rapport with them, and we're also trying to figure out why they're pulling the trigger right now. So after we build the rapport, then we go into more of an educational process of what's the correct size for a wall portrait, you know, depending on the wall that's going on. You don't want it to be too large and overpower the wall, but you don't want it to be too small. We also talk about head size in the portrait and what is considered too small of a head size for a particular overall size of a portrait. We also educate them as to how they're going to see their images via projection. We also, at that point, at the very end, now we start showing them our products and going over our prices. And that's probably the most important part of the consultation, because no matter what you charge, I've learned over the years, people are going to be shocked at your prices. You know, you as a photographer, you have to get over that. And you just have to have the confidence to show those prices. And I like to show them towards the end of the consultation and go over them in great detail so they understand what they're getting into if they decide to go with us. So I think for many photographers, because they're artists and they're not salespeople, this is a part of the process that they don't put a lot of time and effort in, where with us, it's very important that if they're going to get sticker shock, we want them to get sticker shock at that, you know, opening consultation. We don't want them to get sticker shock when they come to order their prints, because that's when they decide, to just get a few smaller prints because they hadn't really thought about, you know, the total cost of what this is going to be. So after the consultation, if we're the right fit for them, we schedule the appointment. We do the session, which is really probably the easiest part of this whole workflow. And so after the session, we try to make it a fun experience. Like Josh said, we don't bring chili and hot cider to every session, but we try to make it fun and something that they're going to remember. And then we go ahead and call them a week or so after that, set up a time for the projection sales. They come in, and by going over those prices as we did in the consultation, there's no surprises. They know if I did my job that they are going to be paying top dollar for these portraits. It's going to be an investment. They're going to be, you know, receiving more of a piece of artwork or artworks for their home rather than pictures. So after the sales process, we order them, they come in, pick them up, and we talk about framing options, or we might deliver the portraits and talk about framing options. Once we get that completed portrait done, then we send them a thank you. In this case of the McNeely family, it was a big bouquet of flowers. So that's pretty much the process. And then after that, we put them in our database. We keep them, you know, in our herd, so to speak, and sending them our newsletters and keeping them in our fences so they don't go elsewhere. So that's really, Nigel, kind of the workflow that we do for the large family wall decor.
Having that consultation in advance of having them make a booking, it sounds like what you're doing during that conversation is you're meeting with them face-to-face, obviously, and talking with them about the benefits of what it is that you do and showing them what you can do and the different options that they have as far as where they can create the portraits and how you can design them to make them look great and all that kind of thing. But it sounds like it's like a set of scales in the sense where you're piling value on one side as you're going through this conversation. And I don't mean monetary value, but, you know, just the sentimental value, the emotional value is kind of piling up on there. And then at the end of the conversation, when you bring in the aspect of price, that kind of goes on the other side of the scales.
Yeah, exactly. It's the value or the perceived value versus the benefits. And once you show that, the whole consultation process to me is probably the biggest thing that I took away from Chuck Lewis and Ken Whitmire. And it's a part of the process that the newer photographers are leaving out. The kind of the new photographer model is, well, we'll charge a sizable fee up front, which for them, it might be $300 or $500. And in their mind, that's where they're going to make their living. It's not on the back end with the prints. And for us, we try to keep our session fee fairly moderate so a lot of families can experience what I can do. And if I do my job, like you said, they will reward me on the back end with the prints. So it's worked for 32 years, and we're going to continue to use this model.
I see the evidence of not using that kind of model all the time on Facebook and some of the Facebook groups of photographers where you see people posting messages like, help, you know, I've got this really difficult client and I didn't know they were going to be this much trouble, and they all of a sudden they want this, they want that, they don't understand my prices, they balk at the prices. And then somebody will say, well, did you explain this to them in the consultation ahead of time? Oh no, this was the first time I met them, was when I put my camera in front of them.
Oops. Yeah, I tell you, man, I actually did a video blog post. We have a membership site for photographers who buy into our style of running a business and photo entrepreneurship. And my post today was, I kind of went on a rant about accountability and how so many photographers on these Facebook groups and stuff, and I watch them and it's like every day, it's just negativity, and clients are out to screw me, and, you know, how do I keep from getting all these horrible clients? And, you know, and it's just, you have to be accountable in your business and you have to dot all the I's and cross all the T's. And that consultation, I mean, I had somebody today that was kind of saying, well, you know, my husband works and I don't think we have time for a consultation. I said, well, I'm really sorry. It's probably the most important part of our process. And they said, okay, well, we'll look around for, you know, somebody else. Okay, no problem. Well, they call back and they said, you know, I talked to 5 other photographers and you're the only one that does a consultation. I'm really intrigued now. It's like, well, why, you know, I was willing to let them walk away because they wouldn't meet with us beforehand, because I know that just doing photography on spec, it doesn't work. You know, especially if you're not selling with projection either and you're just putting them online or a proof disc or something. I mean, you can't make a living that way. And it's one reason why the average professional photographer is only in business 2.5 years now. It's the longevity is not there anymore because they're getting burnt out and they're not making any money.
On the subject of the sales part. Let's move into that. You mentioned just now about the choice of putting photographs in an online gallery on the website or doing it in person by projection. When I talk to a lot of photographers about this, they start to put up all kinds of roadblocks. You know, the ones that don't do projection selling. I can't do that. I've got nowhere to do it. There's no way. I don't have a projector. I don't have a screen. I don't have this or that. So I just put the photographs in a gallery on the website and let the clients pick what they want. Can you explain to us why that's not a good idea?
It's all about first impression. And I'll have to say, if you don't have a brick and mortar type studio, you need to go to their home and you need to bring large portraits and you need to bring a screen and a projector and do what you would in a brick and mortar studio in their home. Is it going to take a lot more time and effort? Yes. But it's really the only way to do it is projection. People's first impressions when they walk in the studio are 40, 50, 60 inch portraits on the wall. You need to show what you want to sell. And if you're just putting them online, then what kind of first impression is the client going to have? If you're not meeting with them ahead of time to go over all this kind of stuff, you're going to run into problems. And Josh will admit, was about this time last year, wasn't it? You made a mistake.
Yeah, about this time last year, I got talked into actually going and doing a consultation at a client's home. And she said she was pregnant, couldn't come in. And I was kind of sympathetic. My wife's been pregnant quite a bit over the last few years. So I kind of broke our own rule. But we did, we brought all the large frame portraits. We went out to her home and, nice home and in a real nice area and cute young couple, first child. They kind of wanted some shots right after the baby was born of the three of them, kind of black and white type stuff. But anyway, long story short, because we kind of broke our own rule and we went out there and, she was pretty much just going through the motions with us. I could tell she wasn't all that interested and
she wasn't really listening.
And, it was hard because she's at home and she works from home and her cell phone's going off. And I mean, it's just when you do that in the client's turf, if you don't have a brick and mortar studio, it's hard. This client ended up being kind of one of those problem clients and we, actually just had to walk away from her. She wanted everything for free and the funny thing is she's living in about $1 million house. Wine cellar's got wall to wall of one of our favorite wines, Cosita Creek. Well, that's about a $300 bottle of wine. She's got about a dozen or two bottles sitting there. So, I mean, obviously she's got good taste in certain things, but when it came to photography, she just wasn't our type of client. She didn't get the process and what we were trying to accomplish. And so it's very important for any sale to be a success. You got to lay the bricks. You got to lay that groundwork in that consultation first. And you're not necessarily selling your client. It's more educating them on what the proper size they should be purchasing is. I got to tell you, the amount of people that come in for that consultation who have this perception of a photographer as somebody that just chases a kid around a park and mails a CD 2 weeks later. An hour later, after meeting with us, they leave and they see the difference. People that during the projection, they see their images on an 80-inch screen. And so now when you're trying to sell a 30 by 40 and the image is 80 inches and you downsize the image, you're selling down, you're not selling up. It's very hard to sell a 30 by 40 from a 4 by 6 proof or a computer screen. People have to visualize it. And actually, that the last step in our sales process for some clients is what we call a final fitting, where we'll take their favorite images that they've already gone through with us at the studio. My dad will go out to their house and actually project on the wall. And that's where we get kind of the final size of what they're going to get. So they can actually see what that 50 inch is going to look like over the couch. And my dad always says, if you do that, the worst thing that will happen is you'll sell one size larger, if not multiples. So, I mean, that's, I guess, for all you kind of newer photographers out there, you stop letting the exceptions become the rule. You got to break through it. I mean, there's a reason why most of the top earning photographers out there use projection. Our friend Sarah Petty, Jeff Lubin, Philip Birmingham, you start naming out all the big guys out there. They all started from scratch like everybody else did too, but it's projection, they will tell you, is what took their business to that next level, and they started to make the type of money they felt that they deserved for their artistry.
I have to agree. I went through the same thing with my business. When I switched to doing projection, it was like somebody had literally flicked a switch and the business just went through the roof. So I can certainly attest to that too. Talking about projection for a second, do you project directly into just a canvas on the wall, or do you use these fancy projection systems where they project a scene of a room with a sofa and then an image above that kind of inset into the image?
No, I'm just projecting right into a screen. Like Josh said, if they need more help, I will go to their home. I know there's different apps out there, and I think ProSelect has a thing where you can take a picture of the room and then kind of superimpose the print. I think from a technology standpoint, that's really cool. But the whole part of the experience that we try to give our clients is major touch points. And that's another touch point to go out to their home and actually let them visualize with you there there what that looks like. Does that take a lot of extra time? Yeah. But will they reward me? You bet. The more touch points you have in any kind of sale, the bigger the sale is going to be. Another touch point that we haven't talked about is what we call the go-see, where after the consultation, I might go out to their home to see exactly where the portrait is going to go, give them a better idea of color and clothing and you know, trying to match the color palette of the home with the clothing, that type of thing. So once again, any time that you can put those touch points into the transaction of the overall sale, the sale is going to be larger. So I guess like old school, and it actually was a lot easier with little Kodak projectors with slides years ago. Now I bring the laptop and the projector. It's, you know, it's a little bit more cumbersome, but it's still very, very effective. And like Josh said, the worst thing that's going to happen is you're going to sell one size larger than what they thought they were going to, you know, buy in my projection room.
I'm intrigued by this idea of these touch points that you just mentioned. And we've talked about some of them throughout our conversation so far. Let's see if we can create a little summary here of where those touch points are in the kind of cycle, if you like, of the typical client. Can we do that? If you give us a little sort of a breakdown of where these important touch points are in that cycle?
Sure. I think we'll kind of both do this. For me, the first is the first contact, and it may be for family portraits or senior portraits. Josh has got it wired into his phone to where if you get an inquiry, doesn't it come out on your phone?
Well, yeah. I mean, it's, you know, email. But I mean, as soon as – I guess the first kind of touch point is whether a client calls via phone or they request for a consultation online through our website, or even with high school seniors, I have my cell phone on there as the texting number. And you would be surprised how many high school seniors text me at 1 in the morning wanting to know about senior portraits, you know. And I think the key with that first touch point is getting back to people in a timely manner, usually within a few minutes if I'm able to. Same with my dad. We're real big on phone messages and trying to get back to people, because what we've heard from other people is most photographers are impossible to get a hold of. You know, they will go weeks without hearing from them, or they send 3 inquiries through their website and no one ever gets back to them. And then 3 weeks later, they get a call from some guy, you know, hey, I'm going through my emails finally, and I saw that you emailed, and do you still need photography work? So, I mean, we try to stay above the fold there a little bit and really get back to people in a timely manner. Touch point number 2 is that actual time they come into the studio for the consultation. That's kind of the first official meeting.
Well, even at the door, it's greeting them at the door or in our lobby and just saying, you know, welcome. You know, thanks for coming, type of thing. That's another great touch point. Taking them back to the consultation room and sitting them down, offering them maybe something to drink would be another touch point. Explaining, you know, what we want to accomplish in the 45 minutes to an hour, you know, why they're here. We want to talk about being able to personalize their portrait, also customize their portrait, those type of thing. And then I would say another touch point would be, you know, after they leave and either following up with a phone call, confirming the go-see, or sending them a thank you. During the session, I would say greeting them at the beginning of the session and really starting to establish some rapport with the kids, especially if the kids are kind of small. We had a session yesterday where I met with the mom and the grandma, but we hadn't met anybody else in the family. And luckily, it was a very stormy weekend here in Seattle. And as we left the studio, it was just pouring. But by the time we got to the home where the portrait was taken, you know, it had stopped. And we saw we had a pretty good sizable window before the rain was going to start again. So we took our time to really, you know, get to know everybody, you know, that was going to be in the portrait, especially the 2 little boys, before we started the session. So I think taking the time to build some rapport, and it's kind of a technique that I think I'm pretty darn good at over the years, building that kind of relationship from the ground up in a very quick manner. So, you know, that being another touch point, the next time I call would be a touch point for them to, you know, schedule a time to come in to see the images. They, once again, we greet them at the door, bring them back, ask them if they want something to drink. So those are the type of touch points I'm talking about.
Yeah, and then I'll just jump in there. It's just, and we already explained our whole process, you know, consultation, then go see, then session, then projection, then final fitting, then delivery, you know, all of those touch points as well. But it's also after the sale, sending flowers. I mean, it's all that kind of stuff. But I think bottom line is a lot of photographers, especially newer ones, are looking for this easy button where all I have to do is take pretty pictures and I'm going to be rewarded handsomely. You know, people go to my website, there's no phone number and there's just an email there, and you know, schedule the session on my calendar app that's on my website, and you know, I'll be in a black car wearing a red scarf. You know, and it's amazing, like at Portraits in the Leaves, we have people come up to our little picnic area, you know, where it's all done up, and they go, "Are you guys our photographer?" And I said, "Well, what's your name?" And they said, "Well, da da." I said, "Well, no, I mean, we meet with all of our clients ahead of time for a consultation." And, you know, it's like, "Oh, well, we've been here for 45 minutes and we don't know where he is." I said, "Well, you know, you're welcome to help yourself to some chili and have some hot cider." And, you know, and then it's just, I think a lot of photographers don't realize that kind of doing business the old school way, talking to people on the phone and really going out of your way, it builds value for yourself and it really helps you separate yourself from everybody else. It's not just about the photography. It's about how you conduct yourself and it's about trying to build that relationship, because we don't view that client as a one-time session. You know, we put a times 20 on their head because we're going to do their high school portraits. We're going to do their wedding. We're going to do their babies. We're going to do their family. We're going to do all the portraits for their business. We're going to, you know, so we definitely have that relationship in mind, and maybe that's why it makes it easier for us to go the extra mile for them.
Well, I think also, and part of who we're an open book, and you go to our website and you read about who we are and what we do, and we're very, I guess, personable and very open with our clients. The number two page, I think, is Sue's page, isn't it?
Yeah. On our analytics, I mean, the number two most visited page on our website is my mom's memorial page, where we talk about her and her contribution to the studio and to our clients' lives and to the industry. And 9 times out of 10, somebody calls to book a consultation and they go, "Oh, you're Josh, you're Bruce's son." I said, "Yeah, how can I help you?" "I am so sorry to hear about your mom. I read about her on the website and, you know, that must have been so hard. You were only 13. I've never met these people before. But because we share so much information about ourselves on our website and we are that open book, I think people just feel like they can really open up to us, which,
exactly,
you know, that's what creates a timeless portrait, is when you can build rapport and connect with your subject. And I think we do a really good job of that from the start.
Having looked through your website, I think you've done a fine job of that whole process. And that connection phase is something that I see missing from so many sites. You know, they focus on SEO and keywords and getting people to just land on the website, but then they don't really think too much about what are they going to do when they get there? Who are they actually supposed to be connecting with, and how, and in what ways, and that kind of thing. And it messes up the whole process, really.
I agree. Yeah.
For photographers new to the business, what would you say are the top mistakes that they make or things that they might overlook?
Well, I think we've mentioned a couple of them. One is they don't project. I think also they see that client as a one-time sale and they want to get as much money up front as possible from them, whatever that is. Those, I think, are two of the top ones. Of course, giving the images away on a CD, they don't understand why people aren't buying prints. When they have the rights to print the prints, when they have the CD, they just don't get that. What do you think, Josh?
I think one of the reasons why you see most of them flame out after about 2.5 years is because their first year, all they're doing is free portfolio sessions. I mean, I see it all the time. They're offering free wedding photography coverage exchange to use the images for marketing. And they spend so much time, I think, trying to justify, "I am a professional, you know, look at my wonderful portfolio," and they're not making any money. And then year two, they decide, okay, now I'm going to get bold and I'm going to charge $100 for a session fee and a CD with 20 images. And then, yeah, they friends and family and everybody start using them and they get 500 Facebook likes and they think, "Man, I'm on my way." And then year three starts. They think, "Well, I'm going to get even bolder and I'm going to raise my prices to $200 a session fee." Then it's like crickets. And it's because there's other people coming behind them that are doing the exact same thing. I mean, it's a really good client of ours had posted kind of some black and white images and they were, you know, they were okay, the little mediocre, but I kind of private messaged the client and I said, "Oh my gosh, you know, I saw your new portraits of the kids and they're getting so big." And I didn't say like, "Why didn't you use us?" or anything like that. And she goes, "Oh my God, I was so hoping you and your dad weren't going to see those. It's this girl at our church. She's a newer photographer. She stood up at the sermon last weekend and offered free sessions and free images for anybody who wanted them because she's trying to build her portfolio and we felt bad for her." You know, so it's that model of feeling like you have to start for free and then get the courage to charge a little bit more. I think the biggest mistake is not really knowing your craft. I think if you want to keep your day job and assist someone like my dad for a year or two and really get to know not only the photography side of things, but the business side of things, and then decide to kind of make that leap into the business, not deciding to make the leap and then now, oh crap, I need to figure out how to use a light meter and I need to figure out how to do this. I think another mistake is not gravitating towards other photographers that maybe have been there for a while. I mean, a lot of these state and local associations are dying because they can't keep their membership, and everyone's going to Creative Live and everybody's going to YouTube to try to figure out how to do stuff. And I think, like my dad would say, you know, when he first started out and he was in year number two or number three of his business, and he, you know, spent the money and went and studied with Ken Whitmire and Lisa Evans and Charles Lewis. And it was that interaction. It was meeting with these other photographers and sort of coming up with some solutions. And it's, you know, Dad, the Chuck Lewis class that you had, you know, it was who was in that class?
Oh, Philip Birmingham and
John Hartman.
John Hartman and Jeff Lubin. And,
you know,
and that was nearly 30 years ago. But most of those guys are still around and still doing well. And it's because it's a sustainable business model. And it's one that, you know, no matter what happens with products and things like that, I still feel that people are going to hang things on their walls, may it be paintings or photographs that look like paintings, no matter how much technology is out there. Art it's not going to go away. The medium is here to stay. And I truly think that the large family wall decor is the future, the salvation of our photography industry.
You know, you guys have been so generous with your time and your knowledge and expertise. I'm so very grateful to have had this opportunity to talk with you. I know that you have your own mentorship program to help photographers who want to learn a bit more about some of the business ideas and the model that you've shared with us today. Can you just quickly let people know how they can find that if they want to learn more?
Yeah, our educational website is called mystudiomentor.com, and there we actually broadcast a weekly web TV show called Photo Entrepreneur TV. It's about 20 minutes long, covers mainly business marketing and management. It's for serious photographic entrepreneurs that want to learn how to profit from their passion. We actually just posted our 41st episode of it. We do it every Monday. It's a lot of fun. It's free. All the archives are free, so check that out. We've had tens of thousands of people view them and comment on them, and we're just having a blast. And then kind of an offshoot of that is we do have a mentor program. It's called DailyDose.Photography, and it's a membership blog. It's about $20 a month, and it's where we really dig in and dive deep, and my dad and I pretty much post a video blog every day, and it's stuff live from the trenches. You know, unlike a lot of other photographic gurus, and if you could see my little air quotes I'm doing right now as I say gurus, you know, we are 100% in the business still. I mean, we run a full-time studio business, 3 employees. We are in the trenches every day. The educational stuff for us is kind of our way of giving back to the industry and also trying to elevate everybody, because if we can elevate everybody to a higher level, all it's going to do is help build more value for photography as a whole. And that's one of the reasons why we do it. So we're photographers first, educators second. You want to close us out here, Dad?
I think you did a pretty good job.
Oh, well, thank you.
Nigel, well, you're doing the same thing. I think we're all in this together. And the more that we can elevate everyone and educate, especially the newer photographers, and also give hope to the more established older photographers that there still is business out there. They just need to learn how to separate themselves from all the newbies that, you know, give everything away. And so our hats off to you for what you're doing as well.
Thank you, Bruce. I really appreciate that. It means a lot. So thanks again on behalf of everyone listening. I really want to thank you guys for being here. It's been wonderful.
Awesome.
Thanks, Nigel.
Thanks for the opportunity.